This is Peter Helen on the show Israel for public access television in South Bend, Indiana. And I'm over here at Mike Jones's studio, and we're right near Notre Dame. And Mike has finished a book on the Holocaust, and I have the manuscripts here. I was able to read it. And the Holocaust is a subject that's hard to get your heads around. At Notre Dame in the 80s sometime, probably because I saw so many billboards at every, at La Fortune, at O'Shaughnessy, everywhere you went, they had something on the Holocaust, somebody speaking, some event you can go to. And I ended up going to the Notre Dame Library and reading Arthur Butz's book, The Hoax of the 20th Century. So I was convinced by his book that it was a hoax, that it was a lie. But I had that card in my hand, but I never knew how to play it. Okay? I didn't know what it meant. And so I didn't think that was the issue I should go after. I mean, my thing at Notre Dame was, I thought, well, they just teach evolution at Notre Dame, and I see the faith being destroyed on that. And so I stayed on that as the primary. But your book seems to succeed in flushing out why it needs to be addressed. Okay? You've always known about the Holocaust, and you never really gave an opinion one way or another too strong.
No.
Okay? Similar to David Irving, because you go into the Zundel trial, and Irving, at that point, switched over. Okay? So he knew everything. He knew about it, and for some reason, he couldn't come out and say where he was, but he finally did. You have not jumped into that, and you really didn't jump into it here as far as, here's my position, okay? That's the way I saw it. Your position is stated by the facts.
Right.
Okay?
Yeah. Yeah, this is a story about a narrative. A narrative which came into existence at a certain period of time. It had a certain purpose, and then it continued, and then it developed over this period of time. So, in many ways, I'm getting back to where I started, which is doing literary criticism. You could say that this is a genre or something like that. It's certain people, it's not just one person, there are a group of people who contribute to this. Something like Southern fiction, you know, a lot of people wrote about the South, it wasn't just one person, you know, you go from Faulkner to other people like William Styron, all those people all had something in common. They're all writing about something like that. That's what the Holocaust narrative is. And people are now starting to write about it. I mentioned in the beginning of the book, a lady by the name of Franklin who wrote, it's in the title.
Ruth Franklin, yeah.
Yeah, I think it's in the title, The Holocaust Narrative. So it's an accepted genre now, and I think that's the best way to deal with it. Because it is, largely, a series of fictions. In probably in every sense of the word. I mean, in the literal sense of the word, it starts off with a short story by a man named Borowski that kind of established the thing. Polish guy who was in Auschwitz. And then it moves to Anne Frank, and then moves from there to Elie Wiesel's Night, and Jesse Kaczynski's Painted Bird, and Styron's Sophie's Choice. In the meantime, you have other films involved in it, The Pawnbroker. The whole subgenre of Holocaust porn that came into being during the 1970s, Schindler's List, crucial issue. And then you have the whole background of this story, which is all the legal battles that were taking place in the same time.
But before, the first time we ever did a show for public access, it was about 2006, Libido Dominandi. Okay, so when I'm looking at this, I'm kind of thinking, this is like a chapter, this fits into Libido Dominandi, you know? I mean, there's a continuity of what you've been doing, and this continues the search for truth, and now this fits in to a bigger picture.
Yeah.
Does that make sense?
Sure. Everything I do is based on something I did before. In many ways, it's always a development of something. So Libido Dominandi was a development, basically. At that point, 20 years of writing articles about some form of sexual liberation. So finally the dime dropped and I realized I had the paradigm. I understood it was a form of control. So yeah, it's part of that. It's part of the Holocaust narrative is inextricably bound up with the trajectory of sexual liberation. They happened at the same time. They happened, the destruction, the Jewish destruction of the production code could not have taken place without the Holocaust.
That's what that Gumar Rudolph, who was the German who, chemist, found himself right in the middle of this, and he did some of the best work on the chemistry and proving could there have been gas chambers there. But he said, first of all, he says that you couldn't even broach the subject, okay?
No.
Because it was, if they thought you were going to bring up the subject that was going to contradict the official narrative, you were already guilty.
So this is precisely what happened over this period of time. Now, that was a crucial, let's say, moment in the middle of this, let's say, beginning with Faurisson, the Frenchman, who first guy to really to question the narrative. I mean, there were other, the major questioning, 78, he wrote an article to Le Monde, letter to the editor to Le Monde, and basically said, did 6 million die in the gas chamber, or something like that, taking on the gas chamber, and then it became kind of like a forensic study among chemists, which is where Gerhard Rudolph came in. He was a chemist. And I think that's what it got focused on. It got focused on, and there were trials in which basically you asked experts. That's when the Zundel trials were crucial in this regard in the 1980s, where he brought in this expert on building a real gas chamber, Fred Leuchter, who built gas chambers for prisons where they were going to execute people. And that trial brought out the precautions you have to take in order to ensure the fact that you don't kill everybody within a 1 mile radius with this toxic stuff. How do you keep that from happening? And you got these seals and very thick doors and so on and so forth. So that came out, but in many ways, that's a sideshow, because the narrative, the story of the Holocaust isn't based on chemistry. It's based on memoirs.
Well, can you, if you remember, the part with Raoul Hilberg?
Right.
And I think it's the first trial. So you had the Zundel, which was, I guess, a mistrial or whatever, in 85. And then in 88, you had the next trial, you had more. But Hilberg was at the first one.
Right.
And he's got like a 1,400-page book. He's the number one historian in the world on the Holocaust.
Right.
And now you have that Doug Christie.
Christie
is a real good attorney. I saw the picture. He's real handsome. Okay?
Yeah.
And so he's going at it. So Hilberg's on there, and then they're asking him, where's your proof? And at a certain point, you had Hoffman. He was there and saying you could hear a pin drop.
Yeah.
Can you relate that story?
Well, he couldn't back up what he was saying. In a sense, everybody took it on face value because it was such a shocking story. It fits so well into other narratives that were being told. At a certain point, it came to a crucial issue of what is the truth? I was thinking of calling this book Wahrheit macht frei, which is a pun on Arbeit macht frei, which is the sign over Auschwitz. It means work will set you free. And this is really a story of how truth or Wahrheit will set you free. Because at a certain point, it became clear that truth was the opinion of the powerful. And if they said it, it was true. And the crucial point here was, I think, around the 1960s, the late 60s, let's say 67. 67 was when the paperback version of Yeshe Kaczynski's book, The Painted Bird, came out. And the New York Times jumped on it. When they say it, it's true. If the New York Times says it, it's true. There's just no way of getting around it. Truth is the opinion of the powerful. And that should have ended the story, but it hasn't. Because truth is great, and it will prevail.
Somebody challenged them.
Yeah, and I think that's what's what this real the story is about. So you can have all of the most powerful forces in the world all agreeing that this is the truth, and what you have to say doesn't make any difference. And then you could go further and you can say, it's so true, we're going to make it illegal for you to question this truth, which is contradictory.
Well, what did Trudeau do during the trucker thing? You talked about that.
Right. I mean, so to get back, so what happened is that you erected a narrative which simply could not be contradicted. And so if you wanted to win every argument, you simply had to employ the Holocaust. And you put that yourself, if you identified your opponents as Nazis, you immediately won the argument. So this is a preposterous reductio ad absurdum of what I'm talking about, is the Canadian truckers are losing money because of COVID restrictions. Now, what's that got to do with the Holocaust? It's got nothing to do with the Holocaust.
Because they were illegal. They were protected by Canadian law on
right.
what they were doing.
So they organize a protest. They start driving their trucks to Ottawa. And suddenly the whole world is focused on this thing.
Everybody has their hopes up.
Everybody. It's like we're all being oppressed by these stupid COVID regulations. We all know it's a form of control. And here the truckers are finally doing something about it. So they roll into Ottawa. And instead of meeting with the people that he supposedly represents, I mean, this is Justin Trudeau, he immediately demonizes. Well, how do you demonize them? He says they're Nazis.
White supremacists.
Wait a minute. This is crazy. There are no Nazis in Canada.
They might have had a Confederate flag, and that's funny.
Well, wait a minute. Are they Confederates or are they Nazis? Are they both the same thing? That's what they're saying here. So it's easy to do this. You can get some agent provocateur to grab a Nazi flag and march around in front of a truck, and there's your evidence. This is part of the problem here. So you start off, how did this thing get started? Okay, we're in the middle of World War II, and there are reports that are coming in from Poland.
Now, the Poles had to flee to Britain for refuge.
Right, so the Polish government in exile is in London. And they're not far from the BBC. And the war is going on, and suddenly they're getting reports from Poland about people dying in gas chambers. They immediately run to the BBC and say that. The BBC immediately broadcasts that. It goes back to Poland, and that generates this feedback loop where the more you report on it, the more you get these reports.
But World War I had a lot of propaganda. And this is not too far from World War I. I mean, so their propaganda...
It's a continuation of World War I.
Yeah, so the propaganda... David Irving said, it takes 25 years after a war normally for things to subside. But in this case, it didn't.
Yeah.
And World War I, you're at the end of 25
years.
Well,
it goes back farther than that. It goes back much farther than that. So what is the crucial, let's say, the crucial issue here? It was basically... the Jewish revolutionaries in Russia who murdered the Tsar. 1881, the Tsar gets murdered. And the Russian people all understand that it was Jewish terrorist organization by the name of Narodnaya Volia, the National Will. And so the Jews are being accused of this, and they claim there are pogroms, although Solzhenitsyn disputes that in his book, 200 Years Together. And at that point, they start moving. They start heading west because they're going to go to the Promised Land, which isn't Israel, it's America. So in order to get to America, you have to travel across Europe to get to Hamburg. Hamburg is in Germany. These places, we're talking about the 1890s, the biggest migration out of Russia during this period of time. So the Jews all live in a place called the Pale of the Settlement. It used to be eastern Poland, now it's western Russia. They have to travel through Poland, and then they get into Germany. Now, the Pale of the Settlement, from a hygienic point of view, is in the Middle Ages. They don't know anything about disease or how disease is communicated from one person to another. The group of people is infested with lice. They are so habituated to the lice that they don't get sick. They're all like Typhoid Mary, you know? They're carrying a disease and they don't get sick. So as soon as they cross the border into Germany, they go from the hygienic conditions of the Middle Ages to the most advanced country in the world when it comes to hygiene. That's Germany. This is the place where postulates were formulated, much more advanced than any other country in the world. And so we have testimony of these people. So this is a woman who writes a memoir. The memoir is published in 1913. And so she says, we were terrified. We didn't know what was going on. The train pulls up. The nurses come in. They get you out of the train. Everybody out of the train. And they don't know what's going on. They can hardly understand it. They're talking in a foreign language. And so everybody's separated according to gender. And then, take your clothes off. Oh, what do you mean, take my clothes off? So the naked women go into a room and they have never seen plumbing. They don't know what a shower is. And suddenly this hot water starts pouring out. And they're scared to death. I can understand how they would feel. I mean, the Germans can be kind of brusque when they deal with people.
That reminded me of a story when we went to first grade. Half of us went to Mrs. Scherholz and half went to Miss Wagner. They were totally two different type teachers. One was the mother type.
Yeah.
And we had the sergeant, German.
Yeah.
And you had girls crying.
Yeah.
And I told myself, well, this is military. You know, I was always trained. Eventually, and I had to put my military thing on and gird up. But some of they couldn't handle her approach.
So this, while everyone's getting a shower, their clothes are being fumigated with a gas called Cyclone B. It's very toxic. That's the whole point
of it. But very effective, and it solves the problem.
Because it seeps into cracks and crevices into your clothing, and it kills the lice. It absolutely kills the lice. So what happened here? Well, gradually those two stories began to be conflated, especially during those reports from the BBC, Poland via the BBC. And suddenly gas is coming out of the shower heads. Now, this is the beginning of the narrative. This is the beginning of the narrative. Now, there are other people. Irmgard Rimland was the wife of Ernst Lindel. She was German. She was Volga-Deutsch. She was retreating with the German army to get away from the Soviet army. And when she crossed into Germany after being in Poland, she was subjected to the same thing, and she was terrorized, even though these people are on my side.
Yeah, even though she's used to their ways.
She's used to it. She'd been seen, I don't know whether she'd seen a shower before or not, to be honest with you. The other guy is Kurt Vonnegut. He gets captured. He's a prisoner of war. Now, he certainly knew what a shower was because he was from America. He's terrified by this experience. So you can imagine these people who don't know anything about what's going on. They're terrified, and they start conflating these two things. And that's the beginning of the Holocaust narrative, the stories of the Holocaust narrative. Now, it adds, at that point, you know, we're now at the end of the war, and the American army is pushing forward as the German army is retreating, and they start coming across the concentration camps. So the first camp that Eisenhower comes across is called Ortruf. Nobody even knows about it anymore. But it's not far from Buchenwald, and when Eisenhower shows up, there are dead bodies all over the ground. Well, that's not made up. They're real. And I'm saying that the essence of propaganda, effective propaganda, is to take an undeniable category of reality, like those dead bodies on the ground, and then you impose the category of the mind on that reality. So it was undeniable in that camp. The worst example was Bergen-Belsen. That was in the British sector. The British army shows up there, and there are literally corpses all over the place. There are trenches that have been dug. The corpses have been thrown into the trench. Now, what happened there is that as the Russian army is advancing from the east, the people in Auschwitz hear that they're coming, and so the Germans go to the prisoners and say, "You have a choice. You can surrender to the German army, or you can retreat with us, and you're going to end up..."
You mean surrender to the Soviet army.
I'm sorry, I said surrender to the Soviet army, or you can retreat with us, and you can go to Bergen-Belsen. One of the people who decided to go with the Germans was Haley Wiesel. Oh, wait a minute. If they're such bad people, if they're an exterminationist camp, why are you going with those people? Anyway, what happens now is that the camps are already overburdened. They're already in trouble because of the Allied bombing campaign has basically destroyed the infrastructure in Germany. And so the Bergen-Belsen, which is already overcrowded, is now inundated with a whole new group of people. All the same problems that you have, multiplied by the fact of proximity, too many people, not enough water, no sanitary facilities, and of course what happens is you have typhus rampant throughout the camp, and people are dying like flies.
That's also in the context where you have 50 million had died around everywhere. It's disaster.
We're talking, so they're in a sense, when you say the Holocaust, it depends on what you mean. If you're saying that people died, many, many people died during World War II, who's going to deny it? I mean, it was horrendous. The millions of people who died, the millions of Germans who were ethnically cleansed.
And 70%, they say, were civilians in most of the last year.
Right. And so this brings up the conflict here. Okay, so the Americans, Eisenhower said at one point when he got to Orbis, he said, he called on the press to come there, Congress was supposed to come there. The American soldier needs to know what he's fighting for. So there must have been some type of doubt.
Well, you had that in there, that, well, if the soldiers don't know what they're fighting for, I think we found something.
So they found something, and this was the dead bodies. And so at this point, you have filmmakers. Billy Wilder showed up to take these films and turn them into a propaganda film. That was the American sector. The Patton told the people, the mayor of Weimar, which is not far from Orndorff, to march to Bergen-Belsen, about 6 miles away, and they were going to put on a show for the German people. At that point, the head of General McClure was the head of psychological warfare. His first assistant was a guy by the name of C.D. Jackson. He became famous, the most famous CIA spook in the 50s.
And his real name was Jacobson.
Right? Jacobson, so he was a Jew. So you've got this undercurrent here of what now that the German army is collapsing, you have Jews, a lot of whom simply left in the 1930s, who are coming back obsessed with vengeance. They want revenge. And this becomes the crucial issue.
But they didn't really go through it themselves. In other words,
they weren't there. They weren't even there.
So their revenge is just philosophical because they didn't.
It's the worst kind. You know? So you're talking about, and this became a huge issue that was dividing the Roosevelt administration. Because on the one hand, you have the Secretary of Treasury, Henry Morgenthau Jr., who was proposing a plan to basically punish the German people. This is not about removing the Nazis. This is not about that type of thing. This is a plan because the Jews are now united in the idea that the Germans are bad people and the German people need to be punished. Not war criminals, the entire German race, the word they would be using, needs to be punished because they are bad people, and if you leave them alone, we'll have World War III. That's exactly the thesis of Morgenthau's book. And so what you have is the plan, the Morgenthau plan, which is basically to starve the Germans to death. Now, I keep saying here, why are we talking about this? Because everything that happened then is happening now, because this is the narrative that determines all meaning. So who knew that the Canadian truckers were a part of the Holocaust narrative until Justin Trudeau opened his mouth? Who knew that basically the Morgenthau plan is being carried out today, as of last week? And what am I talking about? The blowing up of the pipeline. What is that going to do? What did the pipeline do? It brought energy, brought gas from Russia to Germany. What was the main thrust of the Morgenthau plan is to dismantle industry and deny German energy, deny Germans the energy they need to run the factories. This is exactly the plan that's being implemented in Germany right now, except it's the Greens who are doing it. This is why we have to talk about this now. We can't ignore it, because we are once again being dragged to the brink of war, a much more serious war, by a group of people who begin every conversation with, "I have relatives who died in the Holocaust." Can't talk to these people. Once someone says that, they are immediately infallible, and you lose the argument.
Can we say, okay, Mein Kampf, and if you talk to a German, the Inga that was at the market there, he said, we were fighting the Jews. So that war, in a sense, was Germany against the Jews, and the Jews won. Okay, so they won a world war. And now they're going to take advantage of that and impose...
They took advantage of it immediately. Immediately. I'm talking about, I mentioned that Plan A, where the Jews come back and they start murdering people, poisoning people. The smoke was still in the air from the guns or something like that. 45, spring of 45, they're back, and they're going to take revenge. Because revenge is a Jewish virtue.
But they're going to take revenge almost like Cyclon B. They're going to put their influence everywhere. It's going to go into every crack of society.
So, for example, the Nuremberg War Trials, 75% of the lawyers at the Nuremberg War Trials were Jewish.
The ones that had fled and came back.
Yeah, they came back and they spoke perfect German because they were Germans. And now they come back and they're lusting for revenge. And this is the beginning of their attack on Germany. Now, I am saying, if you ever need proof that these people never gave up on the Morgenthau plan, talk about the pipeline.
Germania delenda est. Remember that phrase?
Germania delenda est, yes.
Okay. But like you pointed out, you don't need to destroy Germany just by starving them to death. You can corrupt their morals and just as effectively destroy them.
So that was the crucial turning point. So you've got civil war in the Roosevelt administration. You got Morgenthau, who has this uncanny power over Roosevelt.
And didn't he have the power over the German, I mean, the British financial...
Well, he was Treasury Secretary, so he had...
So they backed off because he had control over their bankruptcy problem.
This is what they say about his influence over Churchill. Churchill hated the Morgenthau plan, even somewhat as ruthless as Churchill thought it was terrible. Okay, so you've got a civil war going on in the Roosevelt cabinet. Because on the one hand, you've got Morgenthau, who has this crazy power over Roosevelt, and he is lusting for Jewish revenge, Semitic revenge, and he's willing to basically starve the German people to death, which is exactly what is happening over the winter of 46-47. The warehouses are full of food. The Americans are not allowing the Germans to eat. This is Morgenthau's plan. Kill them. Well, the other side of the equation is you got these people who understand the implications of this. First of all, they don't like the idea. We're talking about Cordell Hull, the Secretary of State. Talking about the people in the State Department who are WASP, you know, rather than Jewish, like the Jews at the Treasury Department. There's this ethnic conflict going on, and they're saying basically, look, if you keep this up, you're going to drive the Germans into the arms of the Soviets. And secondly, when the Morgenthau plan was made public, Goebbels got a copy. Joseph Goebbels, and he does probably one of the most effective propaganda broadcasts of the war, where he says, the Jew Morgenthau has a plan. He's going to destroy your industry, and he's going to turn Germany into one big potato patch. And he was right. There wasn't a lie in that at all. The Morgenthau, because of this obsession with Jewish revenge, had basically put a weapon into the hands of the Nazis, who then fought even more determinedly. One of the military guys said it was like adding two divisions to the German army because they were desperate. They knew they couldn't surrender at this point. This is what happens when you let Jews do your foreign policy. They take such an extreme position that they bring about the exact opposite of what they intend. It's exactly what's happening right now in Ukraine. Well, once again, the Jews are in charge of our foreign policy. They are promoting, you can't negotiate with these people, and so it's a war, and they're fighting to the end here in something that's completely unnecessary that diplomacy could resolve.
Where the Christian perspective could be totally different.
The Christian perspective is totally different, and there were people then who had enough Christianity to say, this is not what America should be doing. One of them was Herbert Hoover, who was a Quaker, but I mean had that residual American type of Christianity. And he went around trying to overturn the Morgenthau plan. Eventually, they were successful. The adults in the room realized, we don't want to hand this Germany over to the communists.
Especially when America was three-fourths or half German ethnically.
Right, right. So that got resolved favorably in 1948. By 47, the Morgenthau plan, I think it was called Directive 1069, I forget the names, but was replaced.
In here you said there is 60 million Germans on the edge of starvation.
Right. Well, first of all, that's the immediate consequence of the war. But then the long-term consequences, if you break up German industry, Germans cannot cannot produce enough food for that population.
But they kept this kind of secret. Like you said one time, when you were over there, you never heard the stories about American men raping the women, I think it was.
Right.
And when I was over there, 72, I was hearing stories about how they were hungry. You know, we got real thin because we didn't have much to eat. But they didn't really try to blame the Americans back in 72.
There may be something, the fact that you and I are Americans, and they know they're talking to an American, and they know that our country was the victor of the war. They may not say things to us that they might say to each other, even though it was all, I spoke German. It was not as if I were excluded from the conversation because of the language. But the other possibility is they didn't know. There's a lot of stuff that they didn't know. So the man who was most involved in implementing the Morgenthau Plan, well, however you want to define it, I'm saying it has to be defined more broadly than simply this directive, was General Eisenhower, who immediately put it into a plan of starving prisoners of war to death, refusing to declare them prisoners of war, and just putting them outside and behind a fence on the Rhine Meadows, the Rheinwiesen, and they were called the Rheinwiesenlager. And I lived on the Rhine, and I know what the Rhine Meadows are like because I walk around on them. You know, whenever you take a walk, you walk around the walls, the cows graze there. In case the Rhine floods, it just goes there. It's not going to destroy anything. Well, there was a Rheinwiesenlager in Rheinberg, which is about 40 kilometers upstream from where we were. And we used to visit the English there, who were also teaching English. No one ever said that. It was only basically 20 years after I left Germany that the book by the Canadian man by the name of Bach came out and told the story of the Rheinwiesenlager.
His reason is some of them didn't know, or it was suppressed. They just couldn't bring it out. I mean, because it's like the elephant in the room. You give the story about the elephant in the room. How could you not know when you had such a Holocaust there?
Because it wasn't publicized, because the news was suppressed. So you're talking about the age of communication now, where communication is very important. And you're also talking about a period where the Allies, and particularly the Jews here, took over the communications in Germany. There was a Jewish psychiatrist in New York by the name of David Mordecai Levy. And you had to apply to him to get a license if you wanted to start a magazine or something like that.
Well, it's like what Karl Marx said after the Civil War. He said, now the revolution can begin. In other words, once the war was won, now the real war begins.
Well, the real war was against the German people. It's always been though. I am saying that's true to this day. And the proof of what I'm saying is the sabotage of the Nord Stream pipeline. That is right out of the Morgenthau playbook. That is exactly what Morgenthau intended, because you need to cut off the energy supplies so that Germany will revert to an agrarian country. And if Germany reverts to being an agrarian country, 20 to 40% of the population is going to starve to death, because they can't produce enough food there. That's the situation. That was what Morgenthau intended. That is what's being put in place today. So this is the continuity. What is the continuity that links this whole thing together? It's the Holocaust narrative. It never stopped. And now it's not simply a question of, oh, this theoretical history lesson, like what do we... No, this is an existential threat to the German people.
But your insight to the Holocaust is totally different up till now and other people's insight on the Holocaust, namely the whole guilt idea. In other words, the Soviets committed such atrocious war crimes, and we did too. Now what do you do with the guilt of that?
That's right.
And instead of going to the cross, my take would be the Bolshevism, communism, redirected the guilt and put it on the Holocaust.
Yeah, I think that's what happened. I think that's what Eisenhower, if he's a human being, he should have felt guilt for what he did.
And they could have gone to the cross, and they could have gone to Christianity.
That's more important here. More importantly is the situation in Europe. A crucial document, and we've talked about it before, is the Civiltà Cattolica series on the Jewish question.
Yeah, that's what I was going to read.
This is
the conclusion.
This is a time, we're talking about the 1890 when the three-part series came out. This is the official language journal of the Catholic Church, and they are talking about what happens when you break away from Christianity.
Can I read this part? This is the part that I was going to maybe open up with, but here's what you say right at the end. These two go together. The Holocaust narrative has placed Germany to the point of collective suicide. And no one can seem to break the spell because it is illegal to question the Holocaust, the source of that spell. Germany, as a result, sleepwalks towards its doom, convinced, like some crazy Albigensian sect from the Middle Ages, that suicide is a virtuous act. And then you got right here, maybe you want to read it, but I'll read it. The Catholic Church addressed what everyone was calling the Jewish question in a series of articles which appeared in Civiltà Cattolica, the official publication of the Vatican, over the fall of 1890 by calling Europe's attention to what they were calling the voracious octopus of Judaism. Europe was now entangled in the tentacles of that octopus because it had turned away from the gospel. The quote, great truth of the matter was clear. There could be no escape from Jewish hegemony until Europe returned to the faith because, quote, for the nations who have jointly apostatized from the church in order to follow Masonic pretenses, modern Hebrews constitute the scourge of divine justice, unquote. The Jews have turned Europe into, quote, one single huge plantation exploited by the Jews through the labor and sweat of Christians reduced to slavery, unquote. And then this is you. According to the editors of Civiltà Cattolica, there can be no cure for the, quote, the Jewish disease. As long as there are, quote, governments which continue to replace the Ten Commandments, the faith, and the gospel of Christ with the principles glorified by the French Revolution. This is Civiltà Cattolica. If the Christian societies, having been removed from the Church of Christ, won't return to her, they will wait in vain for their liberation from the iron yoke of the Jews, unquote, Civiltà Cattolica. And then you close here. Since Vatican II, the Church has been missing in action on the Jewish question, depriving Europe and the West of the spiritual weapons needed to fight this battle.
Amen, brother. Who wrote that? Oh, I wrote that.
You wrote that.
Okay.
That's
from Civiltà Cattolica.
Yeah, that really...
I think that's exactly the issue. So what happened? We'll go back to 1948. The Morgenthau plan has been repudiated, so technically, it's been replaced by another plan. We'll call it the Marshall Plan, and one of the crucial factors there is allowing money in. So we have the currency reform, money flows into Germany in 1948, the people have money to buy things, the businesses can borrow now so that they can rebuild their industry, and everything seems okay, except that, no, we're not telling you the full story, because the moment the money flowed in, tons of pornography flowed in with it.
Wasn't that the pattern in India? Wasn't that the pattern? It's the IMF pattern. We bring in the money, and there's conditions to the money.
There's always conditions. And so what you're seeing here is the establishment of the principle that the best way to subjugate a population is through pornography and sexual liberation. This is what happened after America conquered Iraq. The country was flooded with pornography. Just had a soldier, met with him when I was on the book tour, came up to me, told me that story. He was there when it happened. The country is flooded with pornography.
Well, we had the girl, one of the comments, I think her name was Angie, and she was going to send me, I still haven't, but she was going to send me propaganda material that our government sent out in World War II that she got from her uncles and that, promoting fornication, basically. I mean, I haven't seen it, but
yeah.
But this is, our military is very close to always doing that.
No, they've done it. I just saw a black guy talking. He's talking about pornography, and suddenly he's talking about libido dominandi. He's talking about me talking about when the Israelis pulled into Ramallah. They started broadcasting pornography on the Palestinian TV stations. That's famous. It's not the only instance. Portugal, 1974, the CIA flooded the country with pornography. So we're talking about probably I think probably technologically, this was probably the first time the government did it. I don't know of an example before that. You didn't have the technology. The technology at this point was glossy magazines. And at that point, the country is flooded not so simply with pornography, but also the justification for sexual license. And that came in the middle of the 50s when the Kinsey Report became common in German illustrated magazines. Now, this is science, so we don't have to worry.
And Germany was susceptible to the voice of science.
Science was probably, I'd say science was invented in Germany, because you go back to Albert the Great, and he was from Cologne. And he was Thomas Aquinas' mentor. Albertus Magnus was his mentor, and he invented science. And Germans were on the forefront all the way up to World War II, when basically we stole their scientific patrimony, stole their patents, and brought all the people over here, like Werner von Braun, so that they could build missiles for us, because we didn't know how to do it ourselves. So now science is being used as an excuse to put pictures of naked women in the magazines, which was illegal.
Yeah, but once science usurped theology as the dominant science, then there's no moral law directing science. You know, what's directing it? Themselves.
Yeah.
And if they want sexual fulfillment, they're going to grab at it.
If there were ever a man who weaponized science, it was Alfred Kinsey. Just a completely bogus charlatan, a homosexual who was obsessed with homosexual behavior and justifying his own deed.
And they just put a statue up?
They put a statue up because...
In Bloomington?
Yeah, in Bloomington. I told Pat Bauer, you got to defund this operation when he was in charge of the budget. He just ignored me because these people are too, their horizons, they're playing checkers and their opponents are playing chess. That's the story of these people in a nutshell. A complete cluelessness when it comes to cultural politics.
But we don't have statesmen. We haven't had statesmen probably.
No.
Since Calhoun and Clay.
No. I mean, Herbert Hoover and these people did a heroic job of basically standing up to the Jews. And now they're being demonized as anti-Semites. There's a new biography coming out of Morgenthau that's going to rehabilitate him. And the article is in Politico. And it basically says, you know, the State Department was riddled with anti-Semites. But what do you mean? What do you mean? You mean people who opposed the Morgenthau plan? Because they knew it was going to, the Soviets were going to benefit from this, and that Harry Dexter White was a Soviet spy who was the man directly under Morgenthau? No, this is, again, a counter-narrative, a fiction that is being imposed to basically redirect the course of human history, of American history, by lying about what happened.
And then to Ken Burns, you know, Roosevelt wouldn't take the Jews, but part of that was the Zionists. Part of the Jews was to direct them to Israel. So it didn't come just from Roosevelt necessarily.
No, the Jews, the Zionists were collaborating with the Nazis because they both had a common goal, which is basically get the Jews out of Europe. The Zionists wanted them to leave Europe to come to Israel because nobody wanted to go to Israel. The Jews were happy to be in Germany, even with all its problems. And that's the story that, you know, as a result, you've got this distortion of history. And now, with things like this Ken Burns documentary, the Jews are overplaying their hand because they're so drunk with power, they're so in control of the narratives that they don't understand that they're wrecking their own narrative. The narrative is very clear, I mean, especially from the American point of view. America is a country that defends helpless people like Jews against bad people like Nazis. That's it. That's the story. If you start saying the Americans are anti-Semites, you're going to wreck the entire narrative, and that's what they're doing. They're doing that right now.
Because their pride, which everybody's inclined to, but they're really inclined to it right now because they have so much power.
They're drunk with their own power. And so this reckless act of blowing up the pipeline is the sign that they're drunk with power.
Is it assumed that we blew it up? Is that the assumption?
Is the Pope Italian? Is there any other rational explanation? Under, they're trying to say, oh, well, maybe Russia blew it up. Why would Russia blow up its own pipeline when all they have to do is turn off the spigot and turn it back on again? What happened here is over this period of time is that basically this war in the Ukraine was supposed to end in about 2 weeks after Russia collapsed under the American imposed sanctions. Well, it turned out the exact opposite.
They actually believed those sanctions?
That's what they thought was going to happen. The Russian people were going to rise up against Putin because they were all starving to death because of the sanctions.
It's going to cause them to unite in their identity.
Well, that's exactly what it did in Germany. It's exactly what this bombing policy with the Morgenthau plan did to Germany. It united the people again. So it had the same effect in Russia. But the main problem is the war keeps continuing. The Russian, the Ukrainians are not doing well. They're losing all this territory.
Well, I just hear the Ukrainians, every time you look at something, Ukrainians had a big breakthrough in the south.
Yes, but they're still, the Russians are still occupying their territory. It's not as if the Ukrainians are 300 miles into Russia. It's the other way around. So what happens at this point is that the people get, the Germans are getting restive. The Germans, there were big demonstrations in Germany which threatened to topple the Schulz-Green coalition. And they kept getting bigger. And at that point, it was simply a political decision. Like if Gerhard Schröder came back as prime minister, all you have to do is say, we're sorry, turn it on, and they would have turned it on, and that would have been the end of the isolation of Western Europe. Energy would be flowing, and that would have been the end of American hegemony over Western Europe, especially Germany. So that's why the Americans had to blow it up. They had to break up that play.
Well, didn't Biden, you have Biden back in February or something, he's fielding questions, and he said, well, we're going to solve that pipeline problem.
We'll take it out one way or the other. Now, that was it. You know who was standing next to him?
No,
it was Schulz. It was the German prime minister. So he's basically, giving him the finger and telling Schulz, we're the boss, and you better go along. And Schulz was the dumb.
It was like the $1 billion thing. Biden is such a tough guy, and I'm sure he could probably outdo you with push-ups. I mean, he's got an infantile mind when it comes to, I'm going to fight you.
He doesn't understand the dynamics of what's going on. And I'm sure he's not in charge. I'm sure he's doing it. And who knows whether... I'm sure he was in on the pipeline story. Everyone was. Donald Trump was in on it. Donald Trump was against the pipeline because it assured German independence from American energy. So America has showed its hand. So this was social engineering that we're talking about, that they brag about. It was not about the rehabilitation of the German people. It was about the destruction of the German people.
Just by another means, especially the sexual corruption.
That's right.
Which is, from the church's position, is the worst type of destruction.
Right. And that's precisely, the church was missing in action, once again.
Well, for a while they weren't. The Schmutz and...
Schmutz und Schund.
Yeah, I mean, right. So they were fighting it.
So the same man who stood up to the Morgenthau plan was Cardinal Frings, who told the Germans to go in and loot the warehouses. It won't be theft because you need that food. They have no right to withhold that food from them. He also stood up to the obscenity waves that swept in after the Morgenthau plan disappeared. And he was a strong supporter of the Volksmarkbund, which was the German Legion of Decency. And they battled what they called Schmutz und Schund.
But then you had... like I told you before, my sister at St. Mary's, 69, came to visit Notre Dame my senior year in high school to see if I wanted to come. Of course, I was already going to come. Well, she had me go to the underground theater, the engineering building, to watch Ingmar Bergman films. That was the cool thing.
It was. He was a crucial figure in the destruction of the German obscenity laws. He did a film. It was a plan. There was a Jew by the name of Harry Schein, who doesn't sound Swedish to me. I think he was an Austrian Jew who went to Sweden to escape the war. And then he had all these connections with the Swedish industry and Hollywood. So they concocted a plan basically to make a simultaneous attack on basically Germany and America at the same time. And the movie was called The Silence. It was Bergman was the man who was the best art film director in the world. He defined what art film was.
Yeah, my sister took a class, and he was the center of attention.
Right, and he did have a great cinematographer, Sven Nykvist, who could really frame pictures in these beautiful. Seven Seal is always my idea of like the classic Bergman film, a serious film. But also, it was propaganda for atheism.
And that's right. That's the point. In other words, we started out saying when I was at Notre Dame, I was worried about evolution. I didn't see how the Holocaust, what it did. But you brought in, no, it did promote a type of atheism. But who would see that? See, that's the whole point.
Yeah, well, I saw it. And the problem, and so the point is, how did that happen? Well, how did it get transferred over to the Holocaust? Well, the crucial guy was François Mauriac, who had won the Nobel Prize. He was a philo-Semite at this point. Was one of the first people to criticize Pius XII, and it was always good to have a Catholic to do the dirty work rather than a Jew. He was beholden to the Jews, and then this Jew shows up at his door, a young Jew by the name of Elie Wiesel, and he hands him a manuscript in Yiddish called Die Welt hat geschwiegen, or something. I'm probably not pronouncing it right. And Mauriac translated into French and created La Nuit, which got translated in English as Night. And Night picked up all of those tropes. The God is silent trope is a significant trope that got put into Wiesel's book, and it was from Bergman. Bergman was doing it before that. Everybody who in Europe who was keyed into art film knew films like Seventh Seal. The sequel to that, I think, was called Winter Nights, and there's the priest, the Lutheran minister, saying, "I pray, and God just ignores me. All I hear is silence." Well, this is Bergman talking. Bergman was the son of a Lutheran minister. Look, the first way God talks to you is through your conscience. So Bergman had the phone off the hook here for a long time, because he's not going to listen to the still small voice of God when God tells him, "Thou shalt not commit adultery."
Well, that's, I was going to open the show with the scripture, and whatever we ask, 1 John 3, whatever we ask from God, we receive from him, because we keep his commandments and do those things that are pleasing in his sight. And the first letter, the first epistle is from Paul, is the 1 Thessalonians. And he lays it out with really the commandments. The first commandment he lays out, which is sexual purity.
Yeah.
Okay. So in other words, God's not hearing your prayers because you violated rule number one.
Of course, that's the explanation, but that's not what the world wanted to hear. That's not why you went to a Bergman movie in 1956 or 57, which is when François Mauriac was rewriting Elie Wiesel's book. So I have grandchildren who go to a Catholic school, and it's mandatory. You have to read Night in every single Catholic school. Some of my grandchildren read it twice in two separate courses. And what do you learn there, completely aside from the Holocaust, is propaganda for atheism. Well, why are we doing this? Why are we doing this?
Well, at the heart of communism and Bolshevism, at the heart of Lenin and Marx, was a real hatred for the idea of God.
Yeah.
And they won the war. So why wouldn't they be?
Yeah, so again, we circle back to the Holocaust as the vector that brought all of these things into our culture. The vector, the reason we are inundated with pornography is because of the Holocaust. No question.
But they also, the Holocaust narrative includes the idea that it was Christianity. It was John chapter 8. It was, actually the cross that produced the Holocaust.
Right. Now, I'm being very specific here. I'm talking about The Pawnbroker, which is a Holocaust film. That broke the production code. And once the production code was broken, we were flooded with nudity.
Because The Pawnbroker allowed nudity because it was art. Holocaust was so sacred.
That's right.
It overrules. Yeah.
The same thing happened again with Schindler's List. Mm-hmm. And what's his name? Who's the guy? Guy has his own show. Stern. Howard Stern complains because they show Schindler's List on mainstream television, regular television. Well, it broke the code. It's got nudity in there. But that's okay because it's Holocaust nudity. And that's an exemption. So the Holocaust breaks all rules. It's an exception to rule. And suddenly you wake up and you realize you're a conquered nation, and all because of the the Holocaust Narrative.
Okay, we got to close. So there's obviously people want to hear a lot more about this. But this is Peter Helen with Dr. E. Michael Jones on the show Israel.